In 1846, at the age of 40, the Reverend John Foley succeeded Robert Gardiner to become the 42nd vicar of the parish of Wadhurst. With him came his wife Caroline, who he had married earlier that year at Elmley Castle Church in Worcestershire. John Foley came from an ecclesiastical family. Both father and grandfather were ordained before him. His father had presided at his recent wedding. With his new appointment and new wife, John Foley set about making a life for them both in their rural community. The Reverend proved, if nothing else, to be extremely fertile. Over the next 9 years, Caroline produced no less than 7 children. Nothing for the first 2 years, then after that, one every year, as regular as clockwork. Tragically though, on October the 29th, 1851, their third child Mary was struck down and died at the age of 3. Her memorial is engraved in the plain glass window in the chancel to the left of the altar. A sad reminder of her short life. Simple evidence of her parents' loss and despair. And then, after seeing this window, you might find reason to look again at the windows alongside. Make note of the names and the dates, and gradually, in stages, come to understand the sorrow sheltered within the walls of Wadhurst Church, because the Foley children were dying. 4 short years after the death of Mary, in the winter of 1856, the family was struck by diphtheria. But in 1856, the only treatments for diphtheria were garlic, comfort, and prayer. Diphtheria is a dreadful, rasping disease, almost eradicated today. Small white spots on the tonsils, accompanied by fever and difficulty in swallowing. Gradually the spots enlarge, ulcerate, and the act of swallowing becomes painful. The fever increases, headache and restlessness. Then the fever seems to break, but very unexpectedly, slowness of breath and wheezing take place. Within a day from this change, the breathing at first falls to 18 respirations per minute, then to 16, and finally to 10 or 8. First to be struck down was Augusta Anne, the Foley's 6-year-old daughter. She lost her gasping battle for life on December the 10th, 1855. Just 2 weeks before her 7th birthday. To have lost one child from your family must have been unbearable. To watch while a second slowly died, unimaginable. But now, the entire family were sick and falling weaker by the day. Despite their mother's desperate care and their father's frantic prayers, 1 week later, on December the 17th, 1855, Celia Foley, age 5, succumbed to the disease. And almost in fear, you move to the next memorial window. And there the full horror is exposed. For on that same December day in 1855, Celia's sister, Caroline Martha, also lost her fight for life. She was just 4 years old. For 3 children to die in just 7 short days, I don't think it's possible to begin to imagine the pain. With Christmas just 1 week away, funerals to arrange, overwhelmed by grief, the entire family sick and fighting for their lives, it must have been a time beyond desperation. That Christmas, the entire parish of Wadhurst would have rallied round the Foley family, their vicar leading them in prayer. Prayers for a better new year. A new year that might deliver them from this terrible void into which they'd inexplicably fallen. But it seems that God was busy elsewhere. On the 3rd of January 1856, Richard Edward Foley, aged 7 months, was taken back to his Maker's arms. His mother, his father, the entire parish's prayers not enough to save him. 3 days later, 20-month-old Robert Foley joined his brother. They were buried together in the grounds of the church. I don't think we can begin to conceive the helplessness of the father. His faith surely tested beyond endurance. One winter month had brought the death of 5 children, each one following the next for no reason and to no purpose. I can't comprehend the suffering of his wife Caroline, or how she could manage to carry on. Each day on waking, one more child was gone. Another was sick, and so little to be done. For the rest of her days, the torment of the first morning's thought, the awful realisation that her 6 children were gone, lost forever in that one agonising winter month. But carry on she must, because still there was one faint hope. Still there was her last son, John. 7-year-old John, who had watched as his brothers and sisters perished around him. John, who would have tearfully attended the funerals at his parents' side, totally unable to understand what on earth was going on. Caroline saved her son John from the diphtheria epidemic. She nursed him through and he survived. The family faith wasn't broken. Following in his father's footsteps, the Reverend Canon John Foley was to die peacefully in Bangalore, India, at 80 years of age. And perhaps this is the greatest secret hidden at Wadhurst Church. Caroline was able to save her son John, and as we mentioned before, if nothing else, her husband was extremely fertile. Caroline would produce 3 more children, all of whom would outlive her as children should. She lived on until 1898. After 42 long years of living with that moment of anguish which came with every dawn, she too was laid to rest alongside her children in the peaceful grounds of Wadhurst Church. Her remaining children made the most of their chances in life and went on to great things, mainly on the continent of India. A solicitor, a famous Buddhist academic scholar, the canon of Bangalore. Caroline and John's grandson even became a famous World War I pilot. Arthur Percival Foley Rhys Davids, the top student and former captain of Eton, shot down no less than 25 enemy planes. Rhys Davids would confess to his mother that once in the air he became a different man, too daring for safety's sake. In what was one of the most famous dogfights in aviation history, he shot down the German fighter ace Werner Voss. Rhys Davids was awarded a Distinguished Service Order, an MC, and then, after his 13th victory, a bar. After flying out one morning on the 27th of October 1917, at just 20 years of age, he failed to return. He was finally posted as missing in action. The Germans sent word that they had buried his body with full military honours. There is no memorial to him at Wadhurst Church.